Admissions last minute, beating our future in threat. But they wish last minute, we will never forget. Can't finish last minute, boss who are upset. EMI payment last minute, leak gaya asset.
But jab baat aati hai tax saving ki,
to mat karo late, nahi to karoge regret.
Isiliye invest karo ELSS mein straight to save taxes and create wealth. An investor education and awareness initiative by L&T Mutual Fund. Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme related documents carefully.
There's a world where every one of us is connected. Everyone. Everywhere. Where everyone is included. Where everyone has access to information, education, opportunity.
There's so much out there. I'm going.
There's a world where buildings are smarter. Where automation fuels productivity. And our planet's health is as important as our own. There's a world where everyone is invited to participate, to contribute, to be bold. When everyone and everything is connected,
that's really beautiful.
Anything is possible. Cisco, the bridge to possible.
Hello everyone. So good evening. I'm Nihal Kumar. I'm an associate member at Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur. And I heartily welcome you all to the 12th edition of Entrepreneurship Awareness Drive EAD, a revising impetus for your entrepreneur ambitions. Presented by Capgemini, co-powered by Cisco and empowered by L&T Financial Services. Established in 2006 with the support of Science and Technology Entrepreneurship Park, ECEL IIT Kharagpur has always worked to promote the startup culture and inculcate entrepreneurial knowledge among enthusiasts. It now functions under the patronage of Rajendra Mishra School of Engineering Entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur strives to bring about a paradigm shift towards its mission in building an enterprising India. Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur provides great opportunities for startups, college students, alumni, and corporates to adapt themselves in this ever-expanding ecosystem. Coming to EAD, the Entrepreneurship Awareness Drive is one of our flagship initiatives. Started 12 years ago, an objective to promote entrepreneurship in campuses across India. EAD implements our motto of promoting startup culture in KGP campus and beyond. EAD acts as a comprehensive guide to the startup ecosystem for startup enthusiasts, consisting of a series of guest lectures and workshops to encourage students to take up entrepreneurship as a career option. Just like all its previous 11 editions, EAD 2021 is the largest ever online awareness drive of its kind, spanning across 25 major cities, inviting 45 plus speakers. After successful completion of EAD at various places, we are back with EAD Jamshedpur. Today, it is my great pleasure to welcome Mr. Tathagat Verma as our speaker. Mr. Tathagat is currently heading the technology strategy and business operations at Walmart Global Tech India and pursuing PhD in AI-enabled business models from Indian School of Business. We are delighted to have him with us speaking on building an AI startup. So without further ado, I would like to hand over the stage to Tathagat, sir. I would request everyone to drop their questions in the Q&A section and we'll try our best to take them at the end of the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Nihal. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you. Let me try to share the screen. Just give me a second. We're all trying out new tools all the time, so I just want to be sure that I have the right one open. Is it coming fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone, and welcome to this session. My name is Tathagat Verma. I work with Walmart Global Tech. I'm based out of Bangalore. I head the strategy and operations function. I'm also pursuing my PhD from Indian School of Business, and my area of interest is, how do we really look at artificial intelligence, not just as a technology, but even as a business enabler? And how does that phenomena really, how do we really explain what's happening there? I'll touch upon some of the things that are of interest area to me, and I think they are also of an interest area to everyone here on this call. So thanks for being on this call Sunday evening. I'll speak for next 20-25 minutes, and then I think we have some time for Q&A. So please drop your questions in the chat box or Q&A, and then I guess Nihal will help me when we get to the Q&A. So the topic I have given is really how do we go about building an AI startup with the caveat that whatever that AI startup means, because sometimes that whole term of AI startup is getting very messy in terms of what does it even mean to be an AI startup. And we'll talk about some of those things and see how we can call out some of the relevant things. So just a disclaimer, these are my personal views, essentially based out of my own research and interest areas, and also based on what I've seen in the last few years in AI space and last 10-12 years in the entrepreneurship stage. I've been associated with the entrepreneurship ECEL for some time as a mentor. So I've also had the opportunity to look at some of them and talk about some of them. Also in this talk, I'm going to really focus not on the specific AI technologies, but I'm really focusing on entrepreneurship as a process and saying, how does AI really get into the startup space there, as opposed to a technology class where we are talking about a specific kind of a deep learning or GANs or any of those underlying technologies, which I'm assuming that most of the folks on this call are aware of, and they are really looking at more from an entrepreneurship lens. So with that, let's just dive into the topic there. And one of the things that I have seen over a period of time is that there are, people have all kind of reasons to build a startup. And what I've learned is that There are top three reasons in my view of building a startup or any startup, forget about AI startup, which is solve a real world problem, solve a real world problem, and solve a real world problem. It cannot be anything else. You might say that I'm really pursuing a hobby, or I'm really building a new kind of an algorithm, or I'm building a new thing. Well, those are fine. Those could be fundamental research, or those could be R&D, or those could be pursuing a hobby or a passion, and there are other ways of doing it. But when it comes to the context of startup, there is a very clearly defined and very well understood expectation from what is a startup really all about. And that is really, we are building a business model to solve a real world problem. That's the way I look at it. So these could be anywhere. I mean, for example, you just have to step outside your home and look at any electric pole and see the mess of wires there. I mean, that's a problem. That's a real world mess that we can be doing. Or it could be as comical as some of you might remember the Big Bang Theory, the lift that's permanently broken. So there are all kind of problems, right? There are things that are always broken. And how do we kind of find a solution to them? So these could be any of those solutions that we might be there. Now, the way I look at it is there are some, I call them as a general preconditions to solving any problem by building a startup. So the first thing is there has to be a problem worth solving, right? Maybe, and we'll talk about some of them. I call them as the pain metrics, like how do you really even assess what is the problem we are solving? But there has to be some problem that is worth solving. That's the first thing. Secondly, somebody wants it solved. If nobody wants it solved, then you probably, well, you can still solve it as an exercise or as an academic exercise, but there may not be a business model emerging out of that. So there has to be someone who wants it solved. And then finally, you have to be interested in solving it. You as an entrepreneur, you as a founder, you as an individual, you as a problem solver have to be interested in that. Now, carefully mark my words. I did not say that you have to be an expert in solving it, or you have to have all the wherewithal to solve it. You may or may not have. In fact, we see startups pivot all the time. They start in a particular problem domain and they end up in another problem domain. If the only precondition was that they have to know every single thing off the bat, then I guess none of the entrepreneurs may qualify for that because they frequently pivot from one to the other. But the interesting thing is that they are interested in solving the problem. And that itself, to me, is the thing that keeps them going for 3, 5, 7, 10 years before they can get to the part of it. And sometimes people say that's a passion, right? Because it's going to be rough and tumble. And you just have to make sure that unless you really fall in love with the domain, you're not going to be able to sustain that energy and momentum for a long period of time. And hence, you have to be interested in solving it. But despite all those things, we frequently see that statistics are really against us. We hear things like 90% of the startups fail and so on there. So why do they really fail there? Now, enough research has gone into that, and there's enough anecdotal data as well. And most of the time, the single biggest reason that experts attribute the failure to is really building something that nobody wants. And that's like as crisply as we can say it. So you're building something where nobody wants it. There's no market for it. So you are just probably pursuing your own hobby or passion or interest area, but then the market is really looking something else there. So that's really the key part of it. You might say I was ahead of that mark timing, but end of the day, there is no market right now. So you have to really design something which is like, do people want it here and now, as opposed to maybe 5 years down the line there. Now, the question comes, why is the market even so important? Because we frequently hear that idea is everything, idea should be there, or technology is really the key part of it. And sometimes people even say that the team is so important, that the team, the VCs really put money in the team and not even in the idea. But like Mark Andreessen, he really talks very passionately about the market. And he says that if the market that don't exist, then they don't care how smart you are, right? So it doesn't really matter what technical chops you bring to the table if there is no market for what you are selling there, right? And he says in a great market, which has a lot of potential, real potential customers, the market literally pulls the product out of the startup. So the market really gives you enough feedback, enough opportunities, enough challenges for you to solve the problem, and the product kind of emerges out of the startup there. And he says lack of market is the number one company killer. So that's really, I think I find it a very compelling perspective that the market is so important there. And the reason I'm talking about in the context of AI startup is that a lot of times we are not very clear about it, as we will discuss, how are we serving this market? So then the question comes, fine, okay, I understand the market is important, but how do I choose the kind of problem I'm going to solve? So this is a kind of a graphic that I have built based on my own learnings and my own experiences. And I actually plot it in a simple X and Y axis. On the X axis, I'm saying there are essentially a spectrum of people. So there are people who can or they want to solve a problem by themselves. At times, they're even willing to live with the consequences of not solving it because they are happy to live with the status quo. Or as we go down the x-axis, we see people are potentially ready to pay others or buy a solution or a service to solve their problem. So you have a spectrum, right? Do it yourself kind of thing. And it goes right up to I'm willing to buy it from outside. So that's on the x-axis. On the y-axis, you see maybe it's affecting only myself or it's affecting only a very small number of people versus it's affecting a large population or potentially everybody. Now, if you plot it, you kind of get four broad sort of broad strokes, actually. And I put them in different colors. So the red color box to me is really the touch me not kind of a thing, because maybe the problem is interesting. I'm not doubting the problem. The problem might be interesting enough, but you probably don't have a market because, well, most of the people are, they want to solve it in a do-it-yourself mode. Which means that they're not going to pay anyone for solving that pain point for them. So you may not have a startup idea. You may not have a business model that's possible in that scenario in the red box. Then you go to the blue box, which is like many people have that problem, but they are still not willing to pay for that. And those could be some kind of a self-help group. So they are coming together and they are helping each other, but they don't really have the propensity to pay there. Now, you may have a solution for them, but it may not be really a business model that can emerge out of that. So you might still get involved. You might still learn something from how people are solving it. And you might even refine it further. It might lead to a sustainable business model. But as it stands right now, it may not really offer a great potential for a business model. The green one is really the perfect problem to have, which is like, there is enough number of people who have that problem, and there are enough number of people who are willing to buy a solution from you, right? So there is a perfect, in my view, I call it as the end state. That's where it should be. So you have a great product and you have people willing to pay for it, right? But then the challenge there is also that because it is so good, everybody is going to jump at that, and then you can expect a cutthroat competition already. So and then if you are trying to enter that market, maybe it's too difficult as a startup, right? On a day one, if you are going for a market which is like a $5 trillion market, imagine there are already established players. There are already established economies of how to do that. They've already put in 8-10 years of effort to get to that point. Are you realistic about your chances of really being able to make a dent in the universe by actually being a 2-person team or a 4-person team, which is taking a shot right on day one at a $5 trillion market or whatever might be the big one that you are after? And then this comes to the golden one, which is the ideal opening, as I call it, which is like, it looks like a small market, but it is basically a small number of people who have this pain point and they are looking for some solution and they are willing to pay for it, right? To me, that really represents the great opportunity there, because they don't have a solution. They have a problem, and it's a smaller number, which means that it is not attractive enough yet for all the people to rush into that, but they are willing to pay for it. So they will buy something if it comes there. And being a small one, it also offers a very natural MVP opportunity, because you do want to really, when you build a product, as you all know, you're looking for a MVP, which is like a sliver of your market or functionality where you want to test it. So in my view, if you are really starting from the golden box, that to me represents the ideal opening there. But anything else, you it's not that you cannot be successful. You would have enough number of challenges, and how are you going to deal with that should be a part of your strategy. So I'm assuming that you're really behind the golden box there. But do share your thoughts on that, because I would love to understand what do folks on this call think about it. So then we go to the question of what do we build there, right? And so again, one of the biggest failure modes I have seen in last 10 years interacting with the startups is that a lot of technology-driven techies like us, for example, we really have a very inside-out perspective. So let's say I know blockchain, or I know cloud, or I know machine learning. I build something there, but I don't really know what problem I'm going to solve. So I try to sell what I can make, right? I also call it as the solution in search of a problem syndrome. So I have built a solution, but I don't know what problem it's going to solve. And I'm now trying to sell that one. Doesn't work. Most of the startups really face a lot of challenges because they are not really sure what business problem they are trying to solve. And when you talk to them, they will try to overnight pivot into multiple of those. But the reality is that it doesn't quite work that way. So the better way to really think is that make what you can sell, and what you can sell is really the market, right? The market tells what you can, what they are willing to buy. So you have to figure out what people want to buy. So the question begs, how do you know what people want, right? But there are many ways of doing it, right? If I take one lens of the kind of research we do, you can have a spectrum, right, from primary research to the secondary research, and there are multiple ways of doing it. This is not an exact graphic, but it just gives you a kind of a spectrum of various ways. So in a primary research, you are doing interviews or observations or surveys of or experiments, right? So you're really trying to talk to the people directly and understand, hey, what is your pain point? How can we help you on that one? And you might also go more on focus groups. You might do some trials. You might do some ethnographic research. And on the secondary research side, you could do obviously a lot of things like user reviews or libraries or trade journals and literature survey and so on. Obviously, secondary research is cheaper because you can just go and do and you can get it, but it's not that accurate. So you have, it's a trade-off between accuracy versus speed and hence cost. Sometimes you might need something to get started by quick and dirty data. So you start with secondary research, but then you eventually need the primary research to really kind of be very clear about what problem are we solving here. Right. And then how do you know that you have found the right problem? Well, there are many ways of doing it and different people have a different take on that. Obviously, if people are willing to buy your solution right away, that's almost always a great sign that you have found the right problem because they are struggling with that. They are actively trying to solve the problem themselves. They ask a lot of questions. They are very curious about it. I mean, those are really telltale signs in my view there. So that with this general introduction, let's just come now and bring this lens to an AI company. First of all, let's just try to establish what's an AI company. And I, as a part of my own research, having done extensive interviews and literature surveys, there's no one single definition. And we don't have to really have that thing. There are people who are calling it as AI company, AI enabled company, true AI company, AI led company, AI factory, AI first, a lot of names are there. And I'm sure this is not the end of it. They'll keep happening there. To me, the bigger question is really to ask why even we should call something as an AI company. I mean, I look at it this way, for example, do you call yourself an electricity company? I mean, electricity is a given thing as a part of it, right? You might call yourself as that we are into making fans or we are making into lighting or we are into making appliances, but you don't call yourself as an electricity company. Or let's say you are into furniture business or you're into office chairs. You don't call yourself as a timber company. Timber is the key ingredient, right? Or let's say you are a chocolate maker. You don't call yourself as a cocoa maker, right? You say we are into artisan chocolates, for example, right? So when we don't really make that distinction, I find it a little difficult to really wrap my head around the fact that we are still calling ourselves like AI company, for example. AI is just one of the enabling technologies there, but it doesn't really qualify in my view to call. That's the reason why I don't even know what does an AI company truly mean. But let's just go with the flow at the moment, because that seems to be the industry lingo at this point in time. So what is really an AI company? And that's just my point of view based on my own research and understanding. And the way I would look at it is that it's essentially a firm that assists, augments, and even potentially replaces human judgment in decision-making by delivering socially acceptable and appropriately explainable prediction solutions by data-driven continuous learning. So there are many terms that we try to unpack that. So it's essentially a firm which is assisting, augmenting, and potentially replacing human judgment. So the key thing we are talking about is it is essentially all about assisting human beings in judging whether that's I should do this or that, what should be, should I say it's a spam, should I say it's not a spam, should I approve this loan, should I not approve this loan, if there is a self-driving car, then I'm looking at, hey, should I really cross this signal, is it really an object or a shadow, for example. So there could be multiple ways of doing that. It is assisting. So the human beings, let us say somebody is doing a fraud, credit card fraud analysis, and it's maybe the human being who is ultimately taking the call. Suddenly your credit card has been swiped for 20,000 rupees and you are not sure, maybe the algorithm is really flagging it and saying, hey, it possibly is a fraud transaction. So it is assisting the human being who is on the case and saying maybe there is a 87% chance it's actually a fraud. And then it's essentially assisting that human being in taking that judgment call, right? Or it can augment them. It can actually give them more data points to basically make a better decision. And in some cases, potentially even replace the human judgment in decision making. So for example, in some of the cases, we are obviously seeing that it has potentially replaced. So for example, you go to your e-commerce website and it says people who bought this book on artificial intelligence also bought this book on something else, right? Now, there is no human involvement at all. It has come to the point where the entire prediction has been directly algorithmically generated and programmatically delivered to you. There's no human being involved in that. And so there are tasks in which the human judgment has been replaced potentially, and there may be tasks where it may never happen there, right? But then the key thing is that it is essentially all about helping in some sense the human judgment in decision making. How does that do that? It delivers the prediction solutions, because end of the day, AI and the machine learning today as we practice is all about essentially delivering these predictions, right? Now, if there is a 0% or 100%, then it is a finite state machine. Then we know what to expect out of it, because those are the transition states that are allowed or not allowed. The key thing is, what do we do when there is a gray area in between, when there is a possibility that it is neither 0% nor 100%, and then that's the reason why there is a prediction scenario there. Now, not every prediction might be, technically it might be correct, there is nothing wrong in that. But then is it really socially acceptable? So for example, we have seen cases of how autonomous cars have had accidents, for example. We have had a situation where this week we read about the fact that Facebook has actually declared that they are going to wipe out the billion plus photographs they have there, right? So we are seeing that while there is a technical capability, that is not the issue here, but socially, is it an acceptable implementation of a given solution there? So that's really becoming a bigger thing as artificial intelligence becomes more pervasive. And is there an appropriate level of transparency or auditability or traceability or explainability of the AI, which is becoming a big thing, which is like, on what basis have you denied me the loan? Is it really a racial bias? Is it an ethnic bias? Is it a gender bias? A lot of those issues are coming up in terms of as we do that. And how it is really delivering is basically data driven. It is not driven by the hunch. It is not driven by guess. It is not driven by expertise that may be non-transferable, but it is really being driven by the data, and it is in the form of continuous learning. So there is a continuous learning that we are looking at in terms of how these prediction solutions are being generated. So that's really how I unpack an AI company. So it's a little mouthful, but then that's how I see those moving parts there. But we also have to be a little careful with that everything that glitters is not gold, right? A lot of companies are calling themselves as AI startups today. In fact, MMC Ventures, one of the firms in London, talked about in 2019, when they audited some 2,830 AI startups in Europe, they found 40% of them do not use any form of machine learning. So there is no machine learning involved in that. They might say that we are using data, they might say something else, but end of the day, there is no machine learning happening there. So if we go with that premise that machine learning or continuous learning by the machine based on the data is an integral part of an AI startup, then 40% of them fail. And this actually, and the reason why still people are calling, in fact, some people call it as the AI sprinkle or AI veneer, which is really a pejorative term to say, well, you want to raise the valuation of the company, you just call yourself as an AI company, right? And nobody really knows because there's no definition of that. So under the hood, nobody has an idea what's really happening. You are actually deploying human labor to do something there. So those are some of the challenges that we are still seeing because it's an emerging phenomena that we are talking about here. So for example, Andrew Ng in his in this course on deep learning talks about that, for example, how do we compare it with from an internet era to an AI era? And just like in an internet era, just because you were a shopping mall which had a website, it did not make you an internet company. Similarly, in an AI era, any company that just kind of slaps the deep learning on it doesn't really become an AI company. There are other nuances he talks about, for example, strategic data acquisition or data warehouse or pervasive automation or even new roles in the division of labor. So there are obviously a lot of those things. So you have to understand that AI company by itself is not just about doing machine learning or deep learning there. There is more than that. So moving ahead, what kind of problems should be solving? Let's say you are an entrepreneur, you want to start your AI startup. What are you going to do? What problems are you really going to take up there? So as Andrew Nux says, well, if a typical person can do a mental task with less than 1 second of thought, we can probably automate it using AI either now or in the near future. So we are really talking about some kind of an autonomic response to something which can be programmatically delivered based on certain, like 30 years back, 40 years back, we would really build a rule-based expert system and kind of do the heuristics around that. So for example, when I was doing my master's, I worked on fuzzy logic-based reinforcement learning. We didn't call it reinforcement learning 30 years back, but it was essentially a fuzzy logic-based system that would simulate a blind man walking up to the cliff. And the whole idea there was that you would say, maybe it is 8 feet, maybe it is 10 feet, and it has to figure out what does the fuzziness of 8 feet or 10 feet mean and actually translate them into certain actions there, right? Now that kind of a problem, we may not be able to do that because it requires a fair amount of cognition. But let us say you're talking about whether it's a fraud transaction or not, whether it's a spam or not, those kind of things, maybe you can do that right away because we have a much better understanding of that. So how do we really choose the problems for AI startups then, right? One of the suggestions that comes is that look for processes or areas where there are a lot of inefficiencies, a lot of repetitive human processes, for example, right? So you have a lot of human thing. And again, we have to be a little cautious with that. A lot of those advices are also coming. The moment you hear about efficiencies or inefficiencies or any of those human processes, you have to put on a very different lens. And that lens is something that a lot of people don't talk about, but I actually like to remind people of that, which is the whole man-machine economics of different countries. So for example, in India, the human labor is still comparatively cheaper compared to the cost of human labor hour in the Western society. So it might be that from a cost economy perspective, it is much cheaper in the West to really replace a human hour with a machine hour. But in India, you might still have the economics against you. So you might have a technology solution, but then the bigger challenge might be that the cost economy of that doesn't really allow you to roll out that solution there. So you have to also analyze it. It's not just a technology play, in my view. It also has to look into the socioeconomic conditions and then really come at the right solution. But nevertheless, looking for processes that have inefficiencies or repetitive human processes is a very good starting point where we can do that. And that actually brings to the question of, well, how do you really quantitatively kind of establish some baseline there? Because qualitatively it is good, but then people can have a disagreement with their opinion. So I'll just give some real, these are some real data points I picked up from the net actually. For example, if you are in retail, now in retail, there is something known as shrinkage, which is basically the inventory theft or the inventory losses. And that is almost 1.7% of the total annual sales, which at $1.8 trillion comes to $31 billion. Now that is a very specific baseline that $31 billion globally are lost only to the inventory shrinkage there. Now that could be a pain matrix, right? We want to change the pain matrix. Similarly, cart abandonment, if you are working in e-commerce, there's something known as cart abandonment, right? Which is like you go and fill up items on your shopping cart, and then at the point of checkout, you basically drop off. you just decide not to carry on with the conversation. And it is that big, right? It is almost between the range of 68% to 74%. So you imagine literally out of four transactions, three of them or out of three, two of them never make it. Now that's a lot of revenue lost or left on the table there. Can you try to solve that problem by bringing AI into that? Or for example, the net non-performing assets in India, for example, with the public sector banks are almost 6 trillion Indian rupees. So that's again a problem. Is there a way that you are able to use AI to basically do some kind of a underwriting or some kind of analysis on what is a higher risk and basically look at that? So I call them as the pain metrics to do that. Now, obviously, the moment you look at quantitative data, you are also getting into the whole realm of data issue. And a lot of startups would face problems initially in terms of how do you get the data part of that. Obviously, if you are building for some customer, it's helpful if you have the customer data or you have the data from the problem domain. But many times it's not there. Well, there are a lot of other sources, alternate sources, may not be as good as what you really need. But for example, there are a lot of government sources available now. Even Indian government, the data.gov.in is available on the public domain. World Bank data is available. So a lot of public data is available there to start your journey if you want to solve some problem there, right? Or a lot of companies have started to put together, like on Kaggle, obviously, there's a lot of data. But recently, PhonePe said for the last 5 years, they basically put all the payment data in the public domain there. And they will refresh it every quarter, for example. Now, that data gives you the opportunity to really being able to, obviously, you have to look at the schema of the data and really see what all data attributes are available to me. But maybe looking at that, you are able to actually cull out certain patterns and say, hey, this seems like a problem here, that, hey, these are the patterns this is throwing people in this particular area. They are talking about this kind of usage, but it is 3 times usage in another PIN code or something else that might be there. Why is it that it is, can I explain this phenomena better? So you have the data, you have to discover the patterns and then see which one really makes sense. You also have a lot of third-party data brokers. You can buy the data from them. Or nowadays, there's a new emerging area of synthetic data, which is also picking up, which is like, can you really create a synthetic data, which is may not be as good really, but it's almost as good as that in terms of really looking at it. It doesn't have any PII data. It is letting you take care of the ethical part of it. And that technology is fast improving actually. So it might be a good idea that you don't, it's a chicken and egg problem. Until you start using it, you don't generate data. Until you have enough data, you don't really have the models you can deploy. But synthetic data can help you break the logjam, and then you can start gradually kind of getting the real data to also substantiate that. Establishing the finish line is important because we are now working with, we have established a baseline of the pain metrics. You are using various algorithms to basically fine tune it and look at it. And you have to establish some finish line because you cannot, like, you have to push it in production at some point in time. So what is your finish line? Are you going to say that on the benchmark test, my performance should be 99%. Well, that might be stretching it a little too far. But if you say that more than 95% I'm willing to do, you kind of gauge against that and you start doing it, right? So these are like the basic things of, if you are going to specially do an AI startup, you have to be even more data-driven in terms of how you make the decisions, when to kind of pivot, when to upgrade, when to release, and other kind of things. So establishing finish line is a great discipline for any startup, even more so for the AI startup there. And then there are a bunch of ideas available. For example, this book on lean analytics actually talks about some very interesting ideas about how you can use the whole idea of building a lean analytics startup, for example, by using the ideas of lean startup. And it's all about really looking at a metric and then really running experiments continuously to in a closed loop to improvise it until the metric is good enough for you to move to the next stage. Yeah. So basically a complex diagram to explain the simple idea that you work in a closed loop system. You start with a baseline state, you have a target state, and internally you are basically applying various methods to test and improvise on that. Right. So that's really the whole idea there. But with the AI startups, some other issues also happen. So for example, we talk of adoption issues. Now, one of the biggest challenges facing in the AI today is that almost 90% of the pilots never make it to the production. So while they work very well in the lab, they work very well in a controlled environment, the moment they are put out in the real world, they are not able to do that. And in fact, 70% of the companies report minimal or no impact from AI. And 85% of the estimates are Gartner estimated they will fail and deliver erroneously through 2022. So there are significant challenges of adoption that are there. Sometimes it is because of the data, sometimes it's because of the use case that is there, sometimes it's because of the embedded processes that are already there, sometimes it's also a talent issue there. So if you are looking at really building the AI startup, you have to understand that while it is great to really build the right pilot there, the scaling really becomes the holy grail of that. And that becomes, again, an issue that is to be done there. And one of the biggest challenges there that I've seen really is in terms of building the industrial scale or robust solutions and then delivering the ROI. So if you look at some of the failures of AI, for example, while like IBM Watson, probably one of the best AI systems that we have, AI platforms that we have, and Watson Health is one of the big ones. Watson for oncology was canceled after $62 million and unsafe treatment recommendations. Or many of you might remember that there was this Microsoft chatbot Tay, which actually was kind of corrupted by the trolls on Twitter. And within 24 hours, it had to be taken down twice. And second time, they discontinued that. Or the face ID being defeated by 3D mask, or the recruitment, like because of the bias that it tends to bring there, because it can be, for example, this particular example, recruitment AI was seen as misogynistic because it was actually eliminating women candidates or anyone who had college name sounding like women colleges, for example. So these are significant challenges that are there. So technology works, but then when we put them in the use case, it's kind of challenging there. And then finally, the last issue really in terms of putting it into production is the ROI part of it. And then that happens, I have seen, because a lot of times we are taking a very inside out view. So we are really pushing the technology as a cute toy, but then not really solving the business problems. And hence the ROI suffers. In fact, this data from Deloitte says that that on an average of 4.3% ROI for the best of the companies compared to only 0.2% for beginning companies. So it is, and then the payback period is 1.2 to 1.6 years. So that's a significant investment that is needed before the ROI is available there. So if you are building a solution, be aware that you are building it for the ROI. You're not just building it for a technology demonstrator. You are building it to deliver a business ROI. And unless there is a business ROI associated, it might be very difficult for a customer to really say, well, what do I do with that? What problem do I solve there? And lastly, I want to just call out one or two points on the technology hype itself. Now, we folks in the technology business, and especially if you are a techie yourself, it's very tempting to fall into the temptation of using the latest and the greatest technology. But guess what? Most of the technology is not really proven to the point that it can actually start being deployed in an industrial context there. So we hear of all these terms, AI governance, we hear of human-centered AI, we hear of synthetic data, I talked about that. We talk of smart robots, we talk of digital ethics. A lot of these technologies are still evolving there. So you have to take it with a pinch of salt and really be aware of it. As you can see in the Gartner hype cycle, that many of them are blue or dark blue boxes. Blue circle is 2 to 5 years, and dark blue is 5 to 10 years, right? And in fact, the ones that we are really interested in, which can be put into production, are really things like chatbots, which seem to be here and now kind of a thing there, or we are beginning to see more on computer vision and semantic search and other ones there. So you have to be very careful in really what technology you really do, because customers don't care, to be honest, about what technology you are using. They are impressed by the problems that you can solve for them. And that, to me, is like, hey, that's okay. How do you really solve it? By using the technology that is proven, rather than something that might be too experimental in nature, right? And then when we lastly go to the scaling up issues, obviously we'll have to deal with a lot of them, but I'm not covering in this short talk here. But there will be a lot of firm-wide and end-to-end use cases, because many cases the pilots start in a very narrow setting inside a function. I'm in a finance team, I'm in a marketing team or somewhere else, or customer support, and I'm really solving that particular point. But unless I can really take a very horizontal view, because customers don't see the vertical silos of the organization, they see the horizontal kind of a value creation. So if I cannot see that end-to-end use case, it might be very difficult, because my data is very fragmented. I cannot like stitch a whole, like a one single view of the customer data. Then experimental learning and A-B testing and feedback, how do I really build it on an industrial scale? And as I talk about this bullet in this below, industrialization of AI is, I think, a bigger thing with the whole ML ops or AI ops that we are talking about, which allows us to also kind of track the model performance and the concept drift and other things there. Then there are issues of data governance and bias there. I mean, in India also, we have the Personal Data Protection Bill that has been presented already. All the countries are really becoming very particular about how we treat the data. So that would be a very important part of dealing with the data and respecting those national boundaries or other compliance requirements, whether it is GDPR or CCPA or Personal Data Protection Bill and other things there. Explainability, transparency, traceability is becoming yet another thing, especially in a mission critical. So let's say you're developing something for hospitals, and then how are you really making the decision that this patient should go for a treatment or surgery and this patient can be treated by medication, for example. It has been a big issue in some of the places in US where lawsuits have been filed because people of one race were actually being treated differently or less severely than the people of another race, and that became a lawsuit issue actually. So those are some of the things again. Then the whole notion of social, ethical, and safe is becoming an important. The concept of AI being a demonic kind of a thing, or taking away the jobs, or disrupting the status quo, or becoming unsafe for the humans. Well, there is a lot of Hollywood there. We as techies and as people in the profession, we should park what Hollywood says. But there are real issues in terms of job losses that we have to be worried about, because if it is at the end of the day going to see, the long-term projections are very different. Long-term projections are that it will take away X number of jobs, but it will create more than X number of jobs over a period of time. And that's pretty much the case with most of the technologies. 25 years back, we thought ATMs are going to be to make people jobless, but banks employ more people than ever before. We thought computerization is going to drive people out of it. I remember growing up as a high school student, those days people used to worry about, hey, what will happen to the people who are doing all the work in like in the railway reservation and all. Guess what? Everybody seems to be hiring more people. New kind of jobs have been created. So the number of jobs that technology takes away, it gives more than that over a period of time. But how do we really reskill the people? How do we really make sure that it can fit into the socioeconomic aspect of it? Otherwise, people are likely to reject that. And this rejection of technology has happened for more than 200 years. Some of you might be familiar with the whole idea of the Luddites, which in England in the first industrial revolution, people came and they started smashing the machines there because they felt they were going out of jobs. So obviously, we have to understand how do we fit inside the social frame and the context in which we are bringing these solutions there. And then lastly, how do we really even design our organization commensurate to delivering the goals of the AI-led ROI? So those are some of the things that are important issues there, which as you kind of scale up, you will be looking at. But to begin with, I thought I'll just focus on these things. And just to quickly recap, a technology does not equate to startup. That's, I think, one of the biggest challenges that I see. I continue to see in startups that are founded by technology engineers and techies that, oh, I know blockchain, I know cloud, I know something else, I'm just going to build the whole thing. Well, obviously, these are important things. They are needed there. But to build a startup is beyond a technology play itself. It has to have a business model. It has to have customers. It has to have revenue streams. It has to have a costing model. It has to fit in the social context of it. All those things are important there, right? So while it might be okay for us to prove a given technology and publish a paper or do a technology demonstrator, putting it in practice in the real world to solve a problem or to build a profitable business model out of it, it would be a totally different ballgame. And the way to think of it is think of the ROI. Well, what is it that I can deliver to a customer value? From a customer point of view, if customer has to invest 1 rupee in that, can they get an ROI which is more than 1 rupee? Or if they cannot get ROI of more than 1 rupee, then what do they do with that? Why should they really use that technology there? So those are the questions that are really important. Data obviously delivers the value, no doubt about that. So data is really the source of competitive advantage, but it is also the bane of the startups there, because a wrongly used data can really make the challenges. And we have seen enough examples of how bad data or wrongly used data or abused data has really been, whether it is in political campaigns, whether it is in market companies, or all kind of issues are there which have to be looked into that. And the final thing that I want to leave you with is that have an outside in thinking. Think about it on what problem are we solving? What is the real issue there? And then really put the filter and see whether AI can really help me solve the problems there, as opposed to saying that, okay, we have learned this new algorithm which is there, which can, I've learned that I can build a GAN to really do that thing. So let me just go and build something there, and then I will figure out. Because this is probably the oldest fallacy in the technology industry. And it started like 150, 200 years back when people built the mousetrap. This whole saying happened, which is like, build a better mousetrap and the world will beat a path to your door. It doesn't happen that way. People have to really be impressed only when their problem can be solved, rather than you kind of selling what you have in your mind, rather than understanding their problem. So these are some of the things that I thought I'll just share in this short talk here. If I'm open to any questions, if they have any.
Thank you, sir, so much for such an informative session. Now we have some questions from audience. So the first question is from Neeraj. AI startup requires a lot of innovation and hence an appreciable amount of funding. How can we plan out of all the financial aspects to convince potential investors?
So I think to begin with, if you are looking at it, there is enough information, there are enough tools available in the open source. And I think I would not really agree that it requires a lot of funding there. In fact, with the open source and with the other models available. In fact, I was reading one very interesting article which says the machine learning projects should start without machine learning. So you do not even have to really think from that viewpoint. Think of a lean startup lens there. In fact, 10 years back, 15 years back, people used to say the same thing about an internet-based startup, that you need a lot of money to do that. Today, you need just a connection, and most of them are available. Those credits are available there. So I think, to me, it's not really about the cost there. It is, yes, data can be a bit tricky to get there, but in terms of the basic tools or basic platform availability, there is enough available out of the box on many cloud platforms that you can start off the bat.
Okay, sir. Thank you. I hope that answers the question. So next question is from Bablu Pandit. How to develop an artificial intelligence strategy?
That's a very, very big question. A lot of companies are struggling, and they would love to get the answer for that. But the key thing to remember is, and everyone has a different requirement, right? Everyone has a different requirement, so everyone will have a different strategy. I don't think there can be a single strategy that can serve everyone. But in general, I feel that the answer in what I discussed in the last my talk is essentially all about saying, how are we solving, what problems are there that can be, that are repetitive, that have a laborious human element. Maybe these are things that humans don't want to do. And you identify them and really turn them into a source of competitive advantage. Today, they might be a leakage of revenue, or these might be wasteful things that you can do. Bring AI into that and really start from there, because these are opportunities that can be there. And that could be an entry strategy for AI. And then over a period of time, you kind of look at a growth strategy and say, okay, now that I have the customer data platform, let's say I built a customer data platform, how can I really add more value to them? How can I extract more insights out of the data? So you could have an entry strategy, you could have a growth strategy, and accordingly you might grow them.
Yes. Okay, so the next question is from Abhyank. How does your AI impact important customer metrics?
So I think the way I look at it is that there are three or four things that AI can really help you to do that. So one is obviously improve your efficiency. And efficiency is your internal measure. The customers may not see it. So for example, you are improving, let's say it takes you 4 hours to process every loan application. From 4 hours, instead of 4 hours, by applying AI, you are able to bring it down to 10 minutes. So now that's an internal efficiency measure that you are able to do. But externally, customers will not see that. Customers will see in terms of a response time. So if you are able to translate this efficiency improvement into a response time, so customer, instead of waiting for 2 days, they can get the whole thing within 1 hour, then that's a big improvement in how your customers are looking at the metrics. So I would say the response time to the customers, the accuracy of your responses, the customer experiences, and how do you measure them? Well, one of the ways you measure them is the NPS, the Net Promoter Score. How much customers are really willing to recommend you and how much they want to do the business with you. So essentially, you are talking about improving the quality of experience for the customers, and you can measure them by NPS. You can also measure how do they vote with their feet. So customer churn is a great way to do that. If your customer churn remains low or it decreases over a period of time, that means more and more customers are embracing your solution. So those would be my customer metrics that I would track. Do we have time for more, Nihal? You're on mute, I think.
Sorry, sir. So the next question is from Patrick. How important is it for the founder to have a strong understanding of the subject before dividing into this sector?
Yeah, so I think that's a very good question, Patrick. The way I look at it is that AI is not really the same as any other software company approach. In a software company, traditionally, we have looked at the whole thing that you, as a requirements engineer, you really figure out all the requirements. As a designer, as a developer, as an architect, you are kind of building the whole sort of a finite state machine of that, and you are then putting it in operations there. Here, you have to understand how AI is really different, how one and done approach doesn't work. You have to continuously monitor the performance of your model, for example, because it keeps degrading or at least drifting away there, for example. How the biases can creep in. And in a lot of times, like deep learning is a great example of that. In a Bayesian kind of a network, we still can build some kind of a explainability into that because we know the a priori's and we know the probabilities. But in terms of deep learning, there is no way to explain the explainability of that. So if you don't really have the right kind of strategy, let us say for training data or for other kind of things, you don't know. You are thinking that I have enough sample, but you have the biases coming in. So I think if you are a founder, you must understand a reasonable amount of artificial intelligence there so that you know what are the sources of bias, how does your model perform, how does the model degrade, how does it add value to the customers and so on. You might still need a data scientist to help you. And you don't have to become a data scientist yourself. You can have a data scientist as a part of the team who really are the experts in the algorithms and the deep networks and so on. But you must be able to really put that in the context of the problem you are solving.
Okay, sir. That was a really insightful answer. So now the next question is from Swabhiman. How is your data at scale different from your data starting up?
A data starting up could be in many cases you might start with a smaller subset because let us say you have chosen a particular, because when you are building an MVP, for example, you might also look at a very narrow definition of it. So you have basically looked at, let us say, people from one zip code, or you have looked at people from one demographic segment, or you have looked at people who have a particular kind of habits there. But when you are actually at a scale, you could get any kind of data. the other day I was actually listening to a podcast on HBR, where actually the author he was talking about, he was a professor who basically used a virtual try-on app, which was actually designed by a women's fashion company, for example, a women's makeup company. It was not even designed for men. So it had never given the data for men to train their algorithm. So when he gave his face to that and gave his pictures, all the results were had no meaning. They were garbled, or they were like, they were rubbish, basically. So you can expect your data to be totally different when you are putting it at scale in a real world situation than what you are starting out with. You will have to build enough guardrails to see, well, your results are not being misinterpreted, because, well, the moment it finds something, you have a choice to make. Either you extrapolate with whatever you have, because data science to me is really all about extrapolating data from and predicting about something based on what you know. So if you are going to find totally different situation, then you will run into all these kind of a things where AI is giving all the wrong answers, or even worse than that. So I think you'll have to really look at all the biases and the sources of differences and other kind of challenges there.
Okay, so we'll take last two questions and then we'll wrap it up.
Okay.
So sure. Next question is from Rishabh. How the gap can be filled the AI is creating or will create in job market?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question, Rishabh, because like I said, see, my own assessment is that it has a very different context, and it has a very different nuances in different markets. So, but some jobs, let us say you have a job that human beings find it very unsafe to do. Now, if it is a job that is fundamentally unsafe and you have an AI available to do that, it definitely will be a great way to do that. But let us say people find it boring, and they find it boring in one area where, let's say, they are paying, somebody's paying $100. But then in another part of the world, if somebody can do that job very happily because there is a different economic market there at even a lesser cost, then there may be a very different economic market for that one. So I think if I have to really see, it will basically create jobs that have lower economic requirement, but higher skill requirement. So I think that's how I really look at that. But every country will have to have its own use case. Every country will have its own price point at which it will really become sort of a fair trade-off between the man and the machine. But yes, when you are doing things like at scale and other things there, if the economics are in favor of that, you will see more and more of those. The kind of jobs that it will create will obviously require more ability to work with the data, to understand the data, it will be human assisted by intelligence. So for example, last year in December, for example, US Air Force flew for the first time an artificial intelligence system as a co-pilot. Now, this was the first of its kind event last year in December, which means there was actually a kind of a fighter pilot there on a reconnaissance mission, which is tracking the enemy missiles. And instead of a human pilot, co-pilot, it was an artificial intelligence there. Now, its job was to basically deploy the system. So you can imagine that you are talking about such kind of safety critical, mission critical, life critical systems as well. So I think it will depend on all kind of things that we are seeing there. Depending on the context, depending on the seriousness, depending on the need, we will find them in different areas and different labor markets.
Okay, sir. Thank you for answering that question. So the last question is from Sivendu Singh. Be it any kind of startup, what is that fine line about which one should really give utmost importance? I'm talking about the transition from ideation to implementation.
I'm not able to fully understand what is it.
So, okay, sir, I'll repeat the question. So Shivendu is asking that be it any kind of startup, what is that fine line about which one should really give utmost importance? He has also mentioned that he's talking about the transition from ideation to implementation.
So I would say, see, my sense is that the basic implementation, the basic artificial intelligence as a technology is fairly proven. There is enough data points available on that one. So you can take any problem in principle if you have the data available, and you can build an AI proof of concept or a pilot around that. So I would say from an ideation or implementation, I would not really, or at least the proof of concept, I would not worry so much. What I would worry about is how do you take that pilot and put it into production? That to me is a bigger challenge, because as I presented the data there, more than 90% seems to be falling off the cliff. We are failing 90% of the times in the pilots there. So that to me is a bigger challenge really than simply proving something in implementation phase.
Yes, sir. Thank you for answering all the questions. I feel that's all we are short of time right now, so we'll wrap it up now. Kindly put forth if you have a message to our audience.
Yeah, I'll do that. Thanks a lot, Nihal. Thanks for the opportunity, and I hope it was useful. Do let me know if you have any questions. I'll hang around on the call, so I'll try and answer some questions in the Q&A chat box itself. But thank you, and I hope it was useful to all of you.
Okay, sir. So I, on behalf of Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur, would like to extend a hearty vote of thanks to Mr. Tathagat Verma for sharing his experience with us. We are extremely grateful to him for taking the time to be a part of EADLSM 2021. I hope everyone had a great time during this session. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
We have our next session soon after this one. We will have Mr. Samar Singla, founder and CEO at Junglebox, speaking on the topic bootstrapping in the age of hyperfunding. Please stay tuned. We will be right back.